Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 1. Important Explanation of Contents. A successful treasure hunter of the sea said, "You have to convince others of what you are looking for, and be incredibly persistent in looking for it." I, Fritz, could really identify with what he was saying. I have searched for truth like a treasure hunter, I have sifted the dusty pages of documents, like a patient miner panning for gold. How far and deep are you willing to search for truth? Cisco and I feel we are accountable to tell you the whole truth as far as we know it, what you do with that is up to you. This book will explain many occult ideas and beliefs, many of them never before publicly revealed. There is an important reason why these occult ideas and beliefs are introduced. We need to study our enemy and know how he thinks. The U.S. Army used Indian scouts to track the Indians. Gen. MacArthur learned everything he could about the Japanese so that he could defeat them. Christ was extremely savvy as to Satan's tricks. The apostle said, "We are not ignorant of Satan's devices." Time and time again, this author has seen powerful Masonic clergymen do their handshakes, their code words, etc. in front of the common people, and the Christians do not catch on. On the one hand, the Christians want proof of what is happening, but on the other hand, they are not willing to learn how to identify what the opposition is doing. Such double-mindedness has contributed to the church's becoming, sad to say, fronts for the Illuminati. I have included the Illuminati's understanding of things and other occult beliefs, because I have witnessed that knowing these things can be helpful in defeating the mind control. If I were trying to help a refugee who was trying to escape the Yakuza, I would study the tactics of the Yakuza. If I were trying to free a witch of Jujuism, then I would learn about Jujuism. I strongly recommend that readers always stand on the foundation of the Word of God, and that they use the Word of God as a refreshing bath to cleanse their minds. This author has found tapes with scriptures to be an encouragement. Some Christians have criticized this author for the content of the books, because it doesn't portray the lighter side of Christianity, whatever that is. It seems some people only want enough of God to make them cozy, but not so much that their sleep would be disturbed. Some have even gone so far as to claim this author is not a Christian because the content of the books is so heavy. It is sad that many Christians do not know their own scriptures nor where hope comes from. True hope is given by the Spirit of God, because hope is the vantage point that the Spirit of God has for the situation. A therapist may be optimistic about a victim of mind control, but the therapist's optimism only turns to sincere hope when they become involved personally with the tragedies of the victim through caring and prayer. The biblical hope is not a warm fuzzy that has its head in the sand pretending that everything is rosy and peachy. Quite to the contrary, if we look at the following portion of scripture, we will see the Word of God portraying trauma after trauma with a light still at the end of the tunnel. Such is the power of our hope, that we have hope in spite of how fierce evil manifests. Lamentations chapter 1. I am the man that hath seen affliction by the rod of his wrath. He hath led me, and brought me into darkness, but not into light. Surely against me is he turned, he turneth his hand against me all the day. My flesh and my skin hath he made old, he hath broken my bones. He hath builded against me, and compassed me with gall and travail. He hath set me in dark places, as they that be dead of old. He hath hedged me about, that I cannot get out, he hath made my chain heavy. Also when I cry and shout, he shutteth out my prayer. He hath enclosed my ways with hewn stone, he hath made my paths crooked. He was unto me as a bear lying in wait, and as a lion in secret places. He hath turned aside my ways, and pulled me in pieces, he hath made me desolate. He hath bent his bow, and set me as a mark for the arrow. He hath caused the arrows of his quiver to enter into my reins. I was a derision to all my people, and their song all the day. He hath filled me with bitterness, he hath made me drunken with wormwood. He hath also broken my teeth with gravel stones, he hath covered me with ashes. And thou hast removed my soul far off from peace, I forget prosperity. And I said, My strength and my hope is perished from Yahuwah. Remembering mine affliction and my misery, the wormwood, and the gall. My soul hath them still in remembrance, and is bowed down within me. This I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope. It is of I'm's loving kindness that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning, great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul, therefore will I hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of I'm. We are in a battle for our minds, are we willing to seize the hope that is before us, or will we resign and say all is lost? Discouragement is not of faith. Do you think Almighty God is a discouraged person? He is calling people to serve others, because God knows that you will never find happiness in selfishness. God is calling people to bind up the broken shattered multiples and to let their deeper parts know that they are loved and worthwhile. To adopt an attitude of defeat before freedom-loving men and women have exhausted all potential remedies for this mind control is inexcusable. Dedication. This book is dedicated to the 2 million Americans and counting who have been programmed with monarch-type trauma-based mind control. This book is written to destroy trauma-based mind control before it destroys the human race. It's time for this horrendous secret to end. It is also written as part of God's end-time work to propel people of faith to the high calling that is prophesied of the body, but cannot be attained without men of faith understanding these things. Humanity's great prophet said he came to heal those whose hearts had been broken, literally split and crushed, and to free those who are captive. That work needs to go forward. Blood, sweat, and tears are associated with this book. The blood of the innocent victims of this mind control cries out in a single unison, along with the pungent sweat of those who have tried to minister help to the shattered humanity left by the sadistic programmers, and the pools of tears shed as this book was written. How long, O Lord, holy and true, do you not judge and avenge our blood on earth? Hope. Thou shalt know that I am Lord, for they shall not be ashamed that wait on me. Shall the prey be taken from the mighty, or the lawful captive delivered? But thus saith Yahweh, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away, and the prey of the terrible shall be delivered, for I will contend with him that contendeth with thee, and I will save thy children. Isaiah 49:23b-25. Warning, read this first before reading the book. If there is any chance you the reader have had mind control done to you, you must consider the following book to be dangerous. If you are consulting a therapist for DID, also known as MPD, it is recommended that you consult your therapist before reading this book. The complications that could result for those under mind control learning the truth could be fatal. The co-authors take no responsibility for those who read or misuse this information. The reader's mind is like a garden. It may not be time to plant the truth in your mind. Perhaps you need some weeding or ground preparation, before the garden of your mind is ready. Perhaps the weather is too stormy to plant the truth. Pray to the Lord of the harvest. The blessings that flow from planting the information of this book in your mind will require the presence of living waters of love. If you do not have love in your heart, this book is not for you. The information contained in this book is the biggest news story of the 20th century, and still the biggest secret. It will challenge you, shock you, horrify you, and hopefully motivate you to redouble your efforts to humble yourself and seek strength from God Almighty. The programming procedures which are described in this book are based on research and consultation with deprogrammers, ex-programmers, therapists, counselors and pertinent literature. To the best of our knowledge, the statements made in this book are factual, although they may not reflect the latest or currently accepted methodology among each and every faction of the New World Order which carries out monarch-type programming. This book tends to devote more emphasis to Illuminati programming, which is the highest level of programming. For individual application in understanding a survivor of monarch programming, therapists are admonished to use this material with consideration for the monarch victim's personal case and situation. The authors disclaim any responsibility for therapeutic work based upon this material. Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler have co-authored They Know Not What They Do, an illustrated guidebook to monarch mind control. Both Fritz and Cisco bring years of experience in dealing with monarch programming to bear on the writing of this book. Fritz has researched the Illuminati, while he has worked with victims of its programming. He has authored the top 13 Illuminati families, and several other books. Introduction by Fritz. There are many dangers to the human race, some real and some imagined. I believe that the trauma-based mind control which this book exposes is the greatest danger to the human race. It gives evil men the power to carry out any evil deed totally undetected. By the time the astute reader finishes this book, they will be as familiar with how to carry out trauma-based mind control as some of the programmers. Ancient and more recent secrets will no longer be secrets. Over the years, I have spent thousands of hours studying the Illuminati, the intelligence agencies of the world, and the occult world in general. The centerpiece of these organizations is the trauma-based mind control that they carry out. Without the ability to carry out this sophisticated type of mind control using MPD, drugs, hypnosis, and electronics and other control methodologies, these organizations would fail to keep their dark evil deeds secret. When one of the mind control programmers of the Church of Scientology, who has left Scientology, was asked about MPD, he said, "It's the name of the game of mind control. Research into this subject will never be complete." This book has tried to give a comprehensive view of how the programming is done. The basic techniques were developed in German, Scottish, Italian, and English Illuminati families and have been done for centuries. Some report that some of the techniques go back to ancient Egypt and ancient Babylon to the ancient mystery religions. The Nazis are known to have studied ancient Egyptian texts in their mind control research. The records and secrets of the generational Illuminati bloodlines are very well guarded secrets. Even when I've learned about the location of secret depositories of some of the Illuminati's secrets in Europe, America, and Asia, their records and secrets are too well guarded to be examined. The intelligence agencies, such as MI6, began investigating these mind control techniques early this century, but their records have been routinely destroyed and tampered with. There are some survivors and professionals who know that the British used programmed trauma-based MPD, DID, agents in WWI. In January, 1987, Richard Kluft submitted an article to the American Journal of Clinical Hypnosis about 8 MPD patients who were between 60 and 72 years of age. Traugott Konstantin Oesterreich, 1880-1949, who was professor of philosophy at Tübingen University, Germany studied MPD and demonic possession and wrote a classic study of it in 1921 entitled Possession Demoniacal and Other, which was translated into English in 1930. His classic work on this subject provides documented cases which reveal that the basic trauma-based mind control was going on in Germany, France and Belgium long before the 20th century. Although he is unable to put together all the pieces and the clues for what they are, the reader of this book might enjoy reading the 1930 English translation of his classic work after they finish this book. Oesterreich's research in early 1900s was the type of research that the Nazi mind control programmers were very aware of. In 1921, the Germans such as Oesterreich would describe personality switches, by the term somnambuliform hypnotic states possession or demoniacal somnambulism or what might be called Besessenheit von Hypnotismus und Bösengeistern. The ability to study both the spiritual and psychological aspects of mind control phenomena is often lacking today. There are exceptions such as Dr. Lorda Fox's book The Spiritual Dimensions of MPD. In the 1920s, the Germans also were aware that the human mind has a variety of ego-psychophysiological states rather than one unified mind, which they termed Subjektlose Psychologie or the psychology of having correlated psychological states rather than the concept of a single ego. The Germans and Italians under the Nazi and fascist governments began to do serious scientific research into trauma-based mind control. Under the auspices of the Kaiser Wilhelm Medical Institute in Berlin, Joseph Menschel conducted mind control research on thousands of twins, and thousands of other hapless victims. Himmler supervised genetic research. The Nazi research records were confiscated by the Allies and are still classified. A trip can be made from downtown Washington, D.C. on a gray government van which serves as a shuttle to the Suitland Annex where the government's secrets are buried, including research papers captured from the Nazi mind control research. Most of Menschel's concentration camp research is still classified. Much of it dealt with mind control. A researcher can visit the top floor, but underground below the top floor are the real secrets. The real secrets are lying in millions of sheets of classified documents hidden behind blast-proof doors. There they have vault after vault, and row after row of top-secret files that only a few privileged persons with security clearances above cosmic, such as with a C3 or MJ security clearance, can visit. Everyone with these high security clearances which I have identified is connected to the Illuminati. Each underground area at Suitland Annex has its own subset of secret access words, known only to the initiated. Most of the OSS records have been destroyed, a few have been left, the important ones have been misfiled or remade. This is according to a reliable British intelligence agent. Also according to reliable inside sources, the CIA is working night and day to remake old records, to expunge all the real dirty secrets from their records. The basement of CIA HQ is known as the pit. In the pit, documents are being shredded and burned on a round-the-clock basis. The large remains of these secrets are sold for landfill. The Illuminati have developed secrecy to a fine art. They train their people in the art of secrecy from the time they are born. Most everything they do is done orally. They are trained not to write rituals and other things down. There is very little paper trail left by the Illuminati. The creation of slaves with photographic memories facilitates the secrecy. But this book is not about how they have managed to keep their trauma-based monarch mind control a secret. They have managed only to keep it a secret to the general public. They have not been able to completely cover up the millions of wasted lives that their programming has ruined. For many years, they were able to shut up and quietly discard their programmed multiples by labeling them paranoid schizophrenics. But therapists are now correctly identifying these people as programmed multiples and are not only diagnosing them better but giving them better treatment. After Candy Jones's husband deprogrammed her enough that she could participate in writing a book exposing some of what had been done to her, the secret was out. See The Control of Candy Jones: Hypnotism and the CIA by Donald Bain. Ever since then, the intelligence agencies and the Illuminati have been carrying out damage control. Their biggest damage control campaign has enlisted the power of Hollywood and the controlled media. This campaign is known as the False Memory Syndrome Campaign, or as those of us who know the facts like to call it, the False Memory Spindrome. The headquarters of the False Memory Spindrome Foundation is located at 3401 Market Street, Suite 130, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 19104. Some of the original founders were doctors of the University of Pennsylvania. The inside story about these early FMS doctors of the University of Pennsylvania is that they practiced satanic rituals during their work days. What is unusual about this is that generally satanic rituals are performed at night, but these doctors did their coven work during the day. I know about these men. Now you can see why these men started the FMS. They started it to cover their own sins, because many of them were abusers themselves. In other words, many of the EMS people are abusers of trauma-based mind-controlled slaves, or the victims of abuse who are in denial about their own abuse from trauma-based mind control. Martin T. Orne, the person credited with founding the FMS, had ties to the CIA. Two members of the EMS advisory board, Ralph Underwager, PhD, and theologian, along with Holida Wakefield, MA, let the cat out of the bag when they publicly supported pedophilia, that is, adults having sex with children. Their support of pedophilia came in an interview with a Dutch magazine, Paedica, the Journal of Pedophilia, Winter, 1993. Although the False Memory Syndrome Foundation gets upset at any mention that there might be a conspiracy by the perpetrators of mind control, because conspiracies supposedly don't and can't happen, they want us to believe that all therapists are conspiring together to implant false memories of abuse into their clients, which could not be further from the truth. Monarch slaves typically run into a great deal of denial by their therapists that anything like this could be happening. The bottom line is that multiple personality disorder, now referred to as dissociative identity disorder, is a recognized bona fide diagnosis. False memory syndrome is not a recognized medical or psychological diagnosis and does not appear in the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic and Statistical Manual 3R nor the recently released DSM-4. Those who followed Fritz's writings have learned about the close working relationship between the Mondavis and the Rothschilds. See his article about the Mondavi/Rothschild Napa Valley Winery. Guess who got the court precedence which gives the EMS some legal ground to attack therapists? The precedence was supposedly a wife who went to a doctor who told her she had syphilis. The wife assumes she got it from her husband and divorces him. Then she learns she doesn't have syphilis. The husband then sues the doctor. Upon this bizarre case rests the legal precedence for a third party to sue a person who gives advice, such as family members suing a therapist. Upon this weak precedence, an abusive father who worked for Monday in a winery in California successfully destroyed a legitimate therapist who was trying to save his daughter who was a programmed monarch victim. Supposedly the therapist had implanted false memories of rape in his daughter, when the record shows that the daughter's mother told the therapist the girl had been raped by the father. When a valid case of SRA and repressed memories went to trial in Washington state involving a police officer whose family was MPD, Dr. Richard Offshi of the false memory syndrome showed up to cause mischief. And mischief he did work. The case involved the children of a Christian police officer named Ingram who had satanically ritually abused his family for years. The daughter won in court, but Offshi of the EMS was not above writing a book full of lies and distortions about the case. Lynn Crook, who was the abused daughter in the case, wrote up a paper exposing what EMS person Richard Offshi did to her. The controlled media is giving full license and great coverage to the EMS people. Rather than fighting the government for scraps of declassified documents which have had their secrets marked out, and which may even be fake documents manufactured by the CIA, I have decided that there is a much better approach to expose the monarch mind control to the world. If a person could never go to Nepal, he can see pictures of it and believe it exists. If a person cannot get into the top secret records of the CIA and Office of Naval Intelligence and MI6, they can be given the exact recipe for creating a monarch slave. I believe that by giving the step-by-step recipe, people will see that A. all the ingredients are available, B. it is possible to combine the ingredients, C. all it takes is the motive to do it, and that motive is self-evident. We'll even provide some of the names and places as we go along. This book will provide the step-by-step recipe for making a monarch mind-controlled slave. It is a trauma-based mind control which programs multiple personalities using every known technique of mind control. Every type of mind control technique has been combined into a group package which makes the total package almost impossible to break. It is this ability to synthesize all these methods into a group package which is so powerful. Edward Hunter, author of Brainwashing in Red China, testified in 1958 before a U.S. Congressional House Committee on Un-American Activities. Since man began, he has tried to influence other men or women to his way of thinking. There have always been these forms of pressure to change attitudes. We discovered in the past 30 years, a technique to influence, by clinical, hospital procedures, the thinking processes of human beings. Brainwashing is formed out of a set of different elements: hunger, fatigue, tenseness, threats, violence, and in more intense cases, drugs and hypnotism. No one of these elements alone can be regarded as brainwashing, any more than an apple can be called apple pie. Other ingredients have to be added, and a cooking process gone through. So it is with brainwashing. Hunter said brainwashing was a Red Chinese threat. He said that the Chinese were the ones using these tactics. In reality, this mind control was being done in the US and Hunter was a pawn to help justify the criminal activities of the programmers should they ever be found out behind their cover of national security. The handlers of mind-controlled slaves carry around a black or gray 3-ring notebook or a laptop computer with the access codes and triggers. Some of the programmers and handlers have this all memorized. The deepest parts, core/gem/executive committee, false trinity etc. are charted in esoteric language such as Enochian, Hebrew, which is considered magical, and Druid symbols. I have never gotten the opportunity to look at one of these, although a number of the slaves who I've talked with have while they were being programmed. These notebooks have color-coded graphs showing the arrangement of altars, the structure of the system, the training of the altars, the history of the altars and other details. All the primary tortures carried out on a slave are coded using date/no.s so that the memories can be pulled up by the programmers. There is a standard set of hand signals, gestures, and codes that allow a handler to work with someone else's slave, but the accepted code among the handlers is to leave another man's slave alone. As one leading psychiatrist put it, different ideologies use the same methodologies of mind control. The Illuminati have secretly put in base programming that allows them ultimate control over many of the other group's slaves. This will be described within this book. For both the ease of reading and the ease of writing, I have dispensed with most footnotes. To provide my sources would double the size of the book, and many of them are confidential. In the past, when I have attempted crediting information, some people have gotten bruised feelings for having been passed over or for being named. When information comes in from several sources, it becomes difficult to pass out credit. I have made conservative judgment calls about what material I could use. Most of this information has been verified by several reliable sources. Confidential eyewitnesses are often the only source, when there is such a powerful conspiracy to keep this vast NWO mind control secret. Paper trails were not left or are not available. Programmed slaves who have worked for the military as mind-controlled slaves have witnessed their files expunged and sanitized. The New World Order in 1981 made training films for their novice programmers. Monarch slave Kathy O'Brien was used to make both the film How to Divide a Personality and How to Create a Sex Slave. Two Huntsville porn photographers were used to help NASA and the NWO create these training films. Undoubtedly, other porn training films exist too. In others' words, there is film evidence of the monarch total mind control, but these porn films are kept in very secure sites. During the last few years, I have visited with ex-programmers, I have visited with hundreds of victims of the monarch-type programming. I have gone to programming sites, I have visited with therapists who work with the victims of this mind control, and I have met several of the programmers of the CIA/Illuminati face-to-face in the adventures of trying to save people from their programming. I hope that God gives me the strength and the opportunity to get the information I have learned out to the world in general. When this information gets out, hopefully it will help lift some of the secrecy of the monarch programming. The monarch programming is a foundation rock of the New World Order that, when pulled up, will reveal the most evil two-legged bugs and slimy critters. When their rock is lifted, they will have to scurry to hide. Because the authors know what the programmers do, they must honestly record several areas of programming that will be controversial. The programmers are very much into demonology. Before therapists close their minds to this subject, the authors would like to point out that they personally know of cases where monarch slaves whose Christian personalities and other altars didn't believe in demonology were talked into participating in real deliverance, and the slaves discovered much to their surprise that work they had unsuccessfully tried to do for years with their therapist was accomplished in a day or two. Some prestigious researchers have decided the subconscious doesn't exist because they can't find it, it's mysterious. To the man in the street, the concept subconscious is as mysterious as the concept demon. Both have been the objects of intense research by U.S./British/GER intelligence groups. In fact, many of the concepts in this book have been purposely obscured by the Illuminati's control over the media and universities. These obscured concepts include MPD, DID, recovered memories, hypnosis, demonic possession, aliens, mind control, the subconscious, a conspiracy to bring in a NWO, truth, etc. The smoke screens of controversy will continue, but those who love the truth, if they seek it, will realize the importance of this book. It's on public record that MKUltra, the mind control research which CIA Director Admiral Stansfield Turner admitted to in 1977, spent millions of dollars studying voodoo, witchcraft, and psychics. On August 3, 1977, at a Senate hearing, the then CIA Director Admiral Stansfield Turner disclosed that the CIA had been conducting mind control on countless numbers of unsuspecting victims for years, without their knowledge or consent. These CIA mind control operations were carried out with the participation of at least 185 scientists and at least 80 American institutions, including prisons, pharmaceutical companies, hospitals, and 44 medical colleges and universities. Many of America's most prestigious institutes of medical research had cooperated with the CIA, as well as numerous big-name corporations. Casey admitted that day that the CIA did mind control consisting of drugs, hypnosis, and electroshock. A few of the victims of the Monarch Project were even awarded financial compensation for their misery. But what was admitted in the spirit of covering up the extent of the full truth. The compensation was actually hush money, because victims were given gag orders by judges not to talk about what had happened to them. It's been a disaster for Monarch victims that so many ministers have ignored those words of their scripture, "For we are not ignorant of the devil's devices." 2 Cor 2:11. This book is a must for those ministers who seriously believe. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. 2 Cor 7:1. In 2 Tim 2:19-21, believers who nameth the name of Christ are asked to purge themselves of their uncleanliness, unclean spirits. There are many top-notch Christians in the churches today who are under mind control, including many of the Christian leadership. I would like to remind Christian ministers that Isaiah the great prophet said, "The Lord God hath given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He wakeneth morning by morning, he wakeneth mine ear to hear as the learned." Ignorance is not godliness. Isaiah learned to speak with the great learned men of his day, just as Paul the great apostle could speak to the learned men of his time. One of the character traits of God is that he is all-knowing. Who says it is godly to be ignorant? The prophet Daniel said Yahweh God reveals the deep and secret things. Dan 2:22a, God's instruments will do this revealing. Jesus' advice to his disciples was in effect to be wise as serpents, and gentle as a lamb. This advice certainly applies in helping the victims of trauma-based mind control. Paul in his letter to the Thessalonians, 1 Thess 5:14, says that in effect that different people need different counseling, but they all need to be treated with patience. The first step in suggesting a cure is to find out what happened. That is what this book is about. This book is about how the occult network creates the problem that therapists and a few ministers try to deal with. But the keys to open doors to healthy solutions for the victims of trauma-based total mind control will reveal themselves in this book for the reader, as this book reveals the nitty-gritty of how the total mind control happens. Christ came to free the captives, Isaiah 61:1. Satanic ritual abuse has a history that is almost as old as history itself. Good King Hezekiah was a victim as a child of SRA. 2 Chr 29, who got free? Moses confronted the satanic magic of Pharaoh as magicians who could create live snakes from sticks. The Apostle Paul had to deal with Simon Magus, a leader of what is now known as Satanism. Solomon, one of the greatest men of faith, backslid and became one of the greatest Satanists of all history. We have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them, as per F 5:11. While we have no fellowship with evil, the mind control programmers are counting on us being so ignorant of their devices that they can hide their control devices behind perversion and filth that many people shy away from. We must be strong enough to face evil and not shy away from it. The victims of mind control must look evil in the face and not look away to gain their freedom. We, who want to help them, must be courageous and strong enough to do this too. This book is written for that divine goal till we all come in the unity of the faith, and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. F4:13 If the body of Christ is to attain fullness, we need this book to weed out the hidden terrible cancer that is consuming the body from within. This book is written for ministers, secular and Christian therapists, and truth lovers of all kinds. If you love the truth, this book is for you. If you see something good in the human race so that our species should be preserved as well as the spotted owl and the sand flea, then this book is for you. If you love the truth, this book is for you. Glossary of how basic terms are used in this book. For those readers who are not familiar with these basic terms, let us introduce you to the definitions under which this book uses them. Alter our usage is trying to follow the programmer's usage of this word. A dissociated part of the mind which has a separate identity and is given cue codes by the mind control programmers to trigger that dissociated part of the mind to come to the front of the mind. The alter's identity may be a gem, rock, a tape recorder, a poodle, a white kitten, a dove, a horse, or even think of itself as a person or a demon. It all depends on its programming. An alter is different from an alter fragment in that the alter fragment is a dissociated part of the mind which serves only a single purpose. The programmers will give an alter a history, and ensure that shadow alters will provide a full range of accessible emotions. Sometimes the distinctions between alters and alter fragments is vague, but examples from the two ends of the spectrum are easy to tell apart. We use the word alter in this book to conform to what the programmer's charts are encoding as alters. A typical main mental created grid would be a grid of 13x13 principal A-coded alters, which is 169 principal alter personalities. In Illuminati systems, ceremonial alters will consist of three alters placed on a spinning pedestal together into triad goddesses or gods. That means that an A-coded altar on some levels is actually three altars spinning together, which must be locked in place to communicate with, and then rotated to communicate to the other two. Beta, this is the second Greek letter, and it represents the sexual models and sexual altars that the programmers are creating. The primitive part of the brain is involved in this type of programming. An early sexual abuse event will be used to anchor this programming. These sexual slaves will develop sexual abilities that are far beyond what the public is aware is even possible. They also receive the worst kind of abuse far beyond what most people's imagination can picture. Beta alters generally see themselves as cats. Councils, Illuminati, the Illuminati has frequent meetings. Some of these meetings are organized to appear acephalous and accidental in their meetings, when in reality they are structured and planned. One group, MJ-12, has gone by the following names: the group, the special study group, the wise men, the operations coordinating board, OCB, 5412 committee, 303 committee, 40 committee, PI 40 committee, and policy planning group, PCG. Some of the formal policy and ritual groups have names that all Illuminati members who have gotten high enough to learn, will recognize. The Council of Three, Council of Five, Council of Seven, Council of Nine, the Grand Druid Council, the Committee of 300, and the Committee of 500, known as Fortune 500. Many of the meetings are conclaves without formal names. The Grand Druid Council is not something fictional, but an actual body of people who formally meet and whose membership we have been trying to keep track of. The groups which make decisions to control this planet are networked together. Each decision has its own origin and route that it takes. Delta, this is a Greek letter shaped like a triangle which symbolizes change in calculus. It has become a favorite word to use in naming things for the occult elite. Delta teams are four-person assassination teams which usually are secret teams. Delta Forces is an elite unit that operates under the Joint Chiefs of Staff that is made up of highly trained total mind-controlled slaves. Delta models are slaves whose sole purpose is assassination. Delta alters are alters within an Illuminati alter system which are programmed to be assassins. These alters are often some of the deepest in a system and in a genie bottle or with umbrella programming. Deliverance Ministry – this book is about how the mind control is done. It is not a textbook on solutions. The use of the term deliverance ministry in this book connotates any person, S, who via faith in God is able to pray for divine help in a fashion that a victim is helped from demonic activity. A deliverance ministry is a natural outgrowth of a life in harmony and fellowship with Yahweh God. However, this is not to be confused with exorcism of the traditional Catholic or witchcraft nature, in which certain spells and incantations are used in a prescribed method. Deliverance connotates divinely inspired faith. Exorcism involves ritual. A deliverance ministry might perhaps teach a person about forgiveness, or how they can renounce an oath, or how to apply Jesus Christ's atoning blood to their life. In this fashion, the person finds deliverance through biblical spiritual principles rather than the efficacy of some ritual or hocus-pocus spell. This book is in no way meant as a blanket endorsement of every spiritual warfare tactic. If anything, this book suggests that ministers learn more about mind control, as well as grow stronger in their walk with Almighty God. Illuminati. The Illuminati are 13 elite bloodlines which have maneuvered themselves into control over this planet. They lead double lives, one for society and a hidden one which is based on a Gnostic Luciferian philosophy which consists of lots of blood rituals. Monarch programming. This was a specific project carried out by secret elements of the US government and intelligence groups. There were, according to someone a few years ago who had access to the computer, S, which contains all the names of active monitored human slaves, 40,000 actively monitored monarch slaves. However, this book uses the term generically to include all victims who have suffered this type of trauma-based mind control. In the same way that a brand name like Hister is used to describe all lifts, when we use the term, we use it in its broadest sense. This is the only way it can be used and technically correct, because as of this date, the authors have not seen who is on the active monarch program list of slaves. System. This term is used in several ways. It is frequently used to refer to a victim of total mind control because the victim consists of alters, programming, implant, S, internal computers, and numerous dissociative states which function together as a system. The word is also used in this book to refer to the body's functional physiological units, such as the respiratory system. The word is also infrequently used to denote the established social, economic, political system controlling the world, also known insiders as the network. Other standard meaning may also occasionally be used for the word. Multiple personality, DID, dash multiple personalities or MPD or dissociative identity disorder is the situation where different dissociative parts of a single brain view themselves as separate persons. The DSM-IIIR definition of MPD is the guideline for determining MPD for this book. New World Order. The New World Order is the global design for a one-world government, one-world dictator and its constituents. Insiders call themselves the network and the neighborhood. Satanic ritual abuse, SRA, dash this is used to represent all categories of ritual abuse which would be inspired by the desire to rob, kill, or destroy something worthwhile in a person, especially their freedom of thought. Many groups carrying out SRA do not mention Satan by that name. They may make pacts to Baphomet, and call upon Rex Mundi, or Belair, or Lucifer, or the Father of Light, God, or Kali, or even Jesus or Jesus Christ. There are demons which call themselves Jesus, who are not to be confused with Yeshua or Yahushua ben Joseph, who is known as Jesus Christ of Nazareth. SRA is not a value judgment by the authors against some group. The victims themselves on some level know that he or she is being abused. Switching. This is when one part, fragment, of the mind takes over from another, or in simple terms, this is when one alter personality, or alter fragment, takes the body from the altar which is holding the body. Switching can occur via the programmer's codes for calling up alters, or by external or internal stimuli that trigger an alter to come out. Switching will usually cause at least a flicker of the eyes, and for outside observers, who know the different personalities, they will observe another personality take the body. Picture cranial.jpg. Picture basic structure.jpg. Picture records.jpg. Introduction. In January 19, 1996, I bound the first copies of the Illuminati formula used to create undetectable total mind-controlled slave. Hundreds of people in the United States and other countries were reading this book, and were expressing their appreciation and praise for the work. Some also contributed more details about the Illuminati's mind control. It was also gratifying that the Illustrated Guidebook to Monarch Mind Control, which contains my co-author's artwork done under programming, was translated and sold this year, 96, as a paperback in Japan. The word is getting out, and people with ears to hear are grateful. The original goal was to write the Volume 2 book to be about 300 pages long, but it spilled into 500 pages. At 500 pages, it was brought to a grinding halt. In this Deeper Insights book, I bring you more profounder mysteries of the Illuminati's mind control abilities. These deeper insights were some items left out of the Volume 2 due to space, as well as some things that have been found out since the Volume 2 book was written. Those who were intrigued by the Volume 2, and cut their teeth on the subject of mind control via my writings over the past 5 years, will enjoy this further expose of the deeper secrets of Illuminati mind control. For instance, scattered in several sections including Chapter 3 is a great deal about the base programs which are laid in using controlled LSD trips in sensory deprivation tanks. Another exciting set of new revelations are Cisco's information on the core, and her revelations giving the chronology of layering in the mind control programming. I have also done a great deal of research into cranial manipulation, see Chapter 8, which has been an extremely well-hidden mind control secret known only to a few select people worldwide. Another area of intense research has been to expose the role Disney played in mind control. Although other writers have superficially touched on implants, nanobots, thought transfer, soul entrapment and other secret technologies, I decided to provide many details to expose these new technologies that are being used in conjunction with the dissociative programmed multiplicity. Beside learning countless programming secrets, the reader will take another quantum leap into understanding what has been going on in this mixed-up world. If life is a riddle, then this book contains many answers to the riddle of life. During the summer of 1996, I had the privilege to speak on mind control to audiences in 12 major American cities, as well talk on over 50 radio stations. The response was encouraging. People are beginning to wake up, and are hungry to learn the truth about how the movers and shakers of this world have developed sophisticated methods to make children into undetectable Illuminati robots, from the cradle to the satanic throne, as well as their extensive abilities to control the common person's thinking from the cradle to the grave. When Christ asked the question, "Will I find faith when I return?" It was a serious question. We no longer live in a situation where we can depend upon our mind and our thoughts actually being our own. Our minds are under a constant assault and manipulation by those who control things. No one is exempt. Fortunately, there are still some rational thinking humans, who can challenge and expose their plans for total control over the minds of the entire human race. I, as a minister and researcher, along with the victims represented by Cisco Wheeler and others, can't expose this mind control on our own. We need the help of others. Will you help us get the message out about the New World Order / the Illuminati's mind control? Cisco has consulted with me, and we decided to make two continuations. The continuation of the Illustrated Guidebook would be authored by her, and the continuation of the Volume 2 book would be carried out by yours truly, Fritz Springmeier. We have combined these two continuations into this book called For Short Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Mind Control Formula. This volume is meant to be an extension of the previous volumes. If you have not read the previous book entitled Volume 2 The Illuminati Formula Used to Create an Undetectable Total Mind Controlled Slave, then you are not really prepared to understand this material. In my previous books, I have shown how the intelligence agencies are simply prostitutes and fronts of the Illuminati. The Illuminati always sterilize their activities, so their actions can't be identified in the flurry of secret intelligence activities. Recently, at one conference on mind control, victims of government mind control were told that their stories were not welcome because the conference was on cult mind control. Dear reader, the intelligence agencies are cults, and not only that, but they have a dark satanic side to them, which not only brands them as cults, but occult cults. Witchcraft and Freemasonry refer to themselves as the craft. How appropriate it was for Alan Dulles, DCI head of the CIA, to entitle his book The Craft of Intelligence. How appropriate it was that people within the CIA referred to their top management as the Knights Templars. As the Volume 2 Formula book indicated, the intelligence agencies which work for the Illuminati have kept only the minimum of records, and the records they do keep are out of reach of people like you and I. But that doesn't mean that the researcher like myself can't work backwards. One of the side effects of the traumas that create multiple personalities, DID, is that sadistic or criminal alters are often formed, and with careful research the historical record of criminals with multiple personalities can be traced back into history. The Illuminati have created trained multiples for centuries, but insiders say that program DID, MPD, was developed in the Nazi concentration camps. The worldwide Illuminati planned the camps with the goal to determine what programs would work on children, and used the cover story of Nazi racial hatred to hide the real purpose of the camps' mind control experiments, which used large numbers of children traumatized by their separation from their parents. With today's sophisticated programming and structuring of MPD worlds, these evil alters can be controlled better than in the past, and yet we still have serial killers like Wayne Cox, and serial rapists like William Stanley Milligan, who were programmed multiple stalking our streets. Kenneth Binney, the LA Hillside Strangler who killed 9 people, was diagnosed as a multiple, but claimed he had faked the disorder. Thomas W. Piper in Boston in the 1870s, and Paul Miskimen, 100 years later in California, are examples of multiples who had an alter capable of murder and another alter who was a good Christian. One of the best disinformation campaigns of the Illuminati is to make people think programmed multiples are just for espionage, prostitution, and assassination. They have taken over our pulpits, like the Illuminati programmed multiple Jimmy Swaggart, and they have taken over our political offices, like Al Gore, and our universities. Even with the elite secrecy intact via their control of libraries, publishing houses, and newspapers, the record still shows the traces of the Illuminati's history of creating controlled multiple personalities. The historical record of criminals with multiple personalities includes the Illuminati Koch multimillionaire Harry K. Thaw. He was one of the elite of society, who had charming sophisticated front alters, and sadistic deeper alters. His position prevented him from being convicted of a murder he committed in public on June 25, 1906. However, another multiple, Henry Spencer, who didn't have such clout, was hanged after killing Allison Rexroad in 1914. Another multiple, William Ahrens, who murdered 2 women in the 40s, had one of his front alters write in the mirror after a murder, "For heaven's sake, catch me before I kill more, I cannot control myself." He had an alter, George, who was doing the murders. The story doesn't stop with evidence of physical murders, but includes the vast numbers of spiritual deaths that have resulted from the spiritual manipulation of the masses via programmed multiples. Programmed multiples have been great for carrying out religious deceptions. Many of the great spiritist mediums were multiples. In the 1920s, Patience Worth was a famous name of an author. Patience was an alter of Mrs. John Curran. As a child, Mrs. Curran had played the piano in her uncle's Missouri Ozark church when young, and then she later grew up to be a famous medium and writer. A Dr. Charles E. Corey investigated her multiple personality disorder. He discovered that her author alter was much more intelligent than the front alter, who did the housekeeping and normally held the body. The occult world has manipulated MPD to manufacture validation for their theories of reincarnation, spiritism, etc. Where once the Word of God was accepted as truth by society as a whole, now society questions whether there is such a thing as truth. When it has come to finding out about mind control from the first level of perpetrators, the government, there have been a number of manufactured, bogus, sanitized and original CIA documents released to the public under the nearly worthless Freedom of Information Act. The Freedom of Information Act has been manipulated to lead people to think that the public has access to secrets. A letter of inquiry in 1995 requesting declassified documents on mind control, Monarch, MK Ultra, Artichoke and Bluebird got the following response from the CIA: "As you might expect, we have already conducted broad-ranging and exhaustive searches and reviews on every conceivable aspect of human behavior, including mind control and brainwashing, and have located and released 11,336 pages of material on the general subject of human behavior studies under MKUltra. Most of the 11,336 pages of this previously released material are very limited in scope and consist primarily of financial records." Quote from a CIA letter of response in answer to a request for declassified mind control information. Yes, and long story short, even those 11,336 pages only got released due to a mistake. In one CIA document pertaining to mind control released under the Freedom of Information Act, which is a memorandum dated October 20, 1975 to the Director of Central Intelligence from the Inspector General Donald F. Chamberlain, the Inspector General states, from his investigation of the Project NAMI, Dr. Stevens has concluded that gaps in the files are the result of a conscious policy on the part of those involved to keep very little paper on the project from its inception in 1952 to its demise in 1970. People formerly connected with the project interviewed by Dr. Stevens asserted that the practice of keeping little or no record of the activity was standard NAMI procedure. Philip Agee, who wrote an expose of the CIA entitled Inside the Company, CIA Diary, Toronto, Ken, Bantam Books, 1975, said that as an employee of the CIA you get so used to lying that after a while it's hard to remember what the truth is. Philip Agee writes, "The life of a CIA operations officer. There is not much time to think about the results of your actions and, if you try to do it well, the job of operations officer calls for dedication to the point of obsession. But it's a schizophrenic sort of situation. You have too many secrets, you can't relax with outsiders. Sometimes an operative uses several identities at once. If somebody asks you a simple question, 'What did you do over the weekend?' your mind goes click. 'Who does he think I am? What would the guy he thinks I am be doing over the weekend?' You get so used to lying that after a while it's hard to remember what the truth is. When I, Philip, joined the CIA, I signed the secrecy agreement. Now I may have violated that agreement. I believe it is worse to stay silent, that the security agreement itself was immoral." Bold added to quote on November 15, 1996, D.C.I. Deutsch of the CIA paraded himself and some politicians before a public meeting in South L.A. broadcast on C-SPAN, and told the people the CIA would investigate allegations that the CIA had run drugs. One man asked CIA Director Deutsch, "Everyone knows that the CIA was running drugs in Vietnam from the Golden Triangle, and that they have continued doing it to today, and you want to come here to South LA and pretend to us that this hasn't happened when everyone knows it did? Are you crazy?" Deutsch couldn't help but show a revealing smile. The above-quoted question was taken from C-SPAN's broadcast and is a closely paraphrased version. One of my questions to Deutsch would be, when a drug addict's life gets out of control, he'll go into denial, and he'll steal from everyone in his life, including his own mother, and live a life of lies, and when an intelligence agency gets out of control, they are like an addicted person, they stay in total denial and keep secretly hurting everyone in sight. What can and should the people do to get an out-of-control intelligence agency to stop its power addiction? Unfortunately, the problem with power addiction, addiction to lying and deception, and drug addiction began centuries before the CIA within the Illuminati families that started the CIA. The CIA is simply reflecting the problems of its parent. Their addiction to lying keeps the common gullible man in public ignorant. Their total mind-controlled slaves are used extensively for disinformation campaigns, and are helpful to disseminate white, gray, and black propaganda for the New World Order's network. To coordinate their lies requires a special intelligence group that keeps meticulous records of the disinformation that has been disseminated, so that they don't get mixed up in their lies. It is extremely rare to get the truth out of the perpetrators, the mind control programmers. Recently, on television, a movie portrayed a victim of trauma-based mind control trying to get one of her programmers, who she'd taken prisoner, to confess to what he'd done. He defied her, and did all he could to make her think her memory was her imagination. It was an excellent portrayal of how hard it is to get the truth out of the perpetrators. The sadistic programmers have exercised their power for decades in secrecy. They have understood the implications of their power for decades. However, the implications of this undetectable mind control are staggering, actually overwhelming, and beyond the man in the street's ability to comprehend. It means every organization can be infiltrated, penetrated as they say, and used as a front or controlled. It means nothing is as it appears. It means that Russia can hate America on the surface, and be working hand in glove on the secret level. It means every one of the millions of new immigrants from Russia, China, and Eastern Europe into the US is a potential time bomb. It means much of what has been blamed on Christians has had its origin in Satan. Satanic programming has seriously damaged the reputation of Christians. The programmers are major players in how the world's events unfold, while they receive absolutely no attention. These men are illegitimate rulers of the world. They have never gained from the common man the right to rule. Therefore, they rule through puppets who owe their total allegiance to their mind control masters. They are rapidly trying to establish legitimacy for themselves, and plan to culminate their plans to gain legitimacy with the rule of the Antichrist, who will rule based on mass-produced myths and fantasies that the Illuminati will articulate to the imaginations of millions of slaves worldwide. They have already begun to market the Antichrist and his reign to the world. The campaign for the acceptance of homosexuality is just one part of this marketing effort. They are also skillfully justifying their Antichrist's rule, by creating problems that only his superior management abilities and leadership skills will be able to deal with. The strength of New World Order and the Antichrist's rule is the total and undetectable mind control that is being carried out on a mass scale to little children and people who fit specific profiles. According to a reliable deprogrammed source, adults, who have the following profile are subjected to mind control. This profile is: alone without a support system of family or friends. An IQ above 120. Good hypnotic candidate. Has other attributes worthwhile to exploit. More about this will be discussed in Chapter 1, where an entire overview of how the intelligence agencies take adults and program them will be given. Adults who are used by the intelligence agencies for wet ops or one-time one-way missions are programmed in stages. These stages are designated levels 1 to 5. Level 4 is where these slaves begin to resemble the total mind-controlled slaves of the Illuminati who have been subjected to mind control since they were defenseless babies. The men involved in the programming of little defenseless children are skilled. They have been earned their jobs on the basis of a dog-eat-dog environment. They are ruthless. They operate out a hidden zone, which I will call the Twilight Zone of Believability. Anyone who tries to expose what they are doing, must write about things that are outside of that box of things commonly believed in. It is as they intentionally gauge what is believable and then step outside of that zone in which to operate. These ruthless programmers have egos which think they are godmen. Somewhere deep in their minds, they inwardly know they are worms. There is a part of themselves deep down that knows the truth, but Satan has buried that so deep, that they cannot face the reality of who they are. They seek eternal life by stealing the life force of innocent victims. They know that their father is Satan. They are victims of Satan. Where does one draw the line between who is a victim and who is an abuser? There is no line. The Word of God indicates that God has turned many of these men over to Satan due to their wicked minds. It's sad to think that some of these men are dependent on Satan for spiritual life. Many of the slaves still have a spark of reality and a spirit that cries for freedom. They have ears to hear the truth, should it come their way. This book is written for those who love the truth and love the liberty that Almighty God has given us to seek and to love the truth for ourselves. Although only a minority of the people today have total mind control, the Illuminati are attempting to confuse and manipulate everyone. One of their favorite tactics to scare people with is the ambiguous bogeyman of national security. They constantly use their spin doctors to whip up fear, so that the public will gladly surrender their freedom to protect national security. Unfortunately, or ironically, the very concept of national security is being used as a cover for the Illuminati to steal every last vestige of freedom left to the American people. American tax dollars support secret conferences such as the classified conference sponsored by Los Alamos on November 16 to 17, 1993, where the Applied Physics Lab of Johns Hopkins University taught our military about non-lethal weapons. The Satanist/ex-Green Beret Dr. John Alexander, now head of the Los Alamos National Lab, gave one of the opening talks on November 16, 1993. The next day, the military men gave talks on the technology involved in controlling people's minds electronically via both implants and energy beamed at them. Dr. Dave Morgan, of Lockheed Sanders, also gave a specific talk on their SINTL synthetic voices they place in the heads of victims with telemetry to auditory implants. You will read more on their implants in Chapter 5. The battle for the freedom of the human mind must be fought now. The battle gets increasingly difficult, but we must fight it whether we win or lose, for the human spirit and the human mind was not created by God for slavery to Satan and his Antichrist. Over and over, the truth of Jesus' words still shine forth, and you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. Let us realize that the man who said those eternally powerful words also said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." For his light shone in darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. If those of us who still have free minds must die, then let us die for the truth, that the truth in Christ Jesus shall live. The hidden world order government that increasingly controls our lives operates through many clandestine operations and groups. What you see is not what you get. In order to maintain total secrecy of such a vast scale of operations, they use millions of mind-controlled slaves worldwide as well as numerous willing servants who out of raw terror will not buck the system. On the surface, EPIC is just another secret military unit. The patch below belongs to the EPIC unit, a clandestine unit which is doing the real banking for part of Mexico, much of the US and part of Canada. This agency, El Paso Intelligence Center EPIC, is obviously not a US jurisdictional agency, but operates under FinCEN, Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, as in Crimes Against Big Brother. This unit is stationed at FT. Bliss, which contains Army and Air Force units. American elections are rigged, and there is no longer a government of the people, for the people and by the people, if there ever was one. The American people are kept in place because they think they elected the government that rules them. Mind control is pervasive and is being used not just to create sexual slaves, or banking employees, but to control society at all levels. Will we continue to allow a shadow government to rule us? Will we continue to let them tell us that these things have to be secret in the interest of national security, when in reality they are only in the interest of national slavery? EPIC is also involved with the NAFTA machinations, many of which were done with the help of mind-controlled slaves. Within the NAFTA agreement was the U.S./Mexico Border XXI framework document, based on the La Paz Agreement signed in 83, which in effect ends American and Mexican sovereignty over all land within 52.5 miles of the border. Special international agencies have been created to regulate the various environmental and legal needs of the Border XXI region, as the border is dissolved into a border region. The U.S./Mex Border XXI document created the Border Cooperation Project and the North American Development Bank. The World Bank will also provide financing, and some funds will come from Mexico. EPIC is well situated in the approximate geographic center of this border region.